Our initial guest is a gentleman who's been working in the medical field for over 36 years. He's a professor of neurology and addiction medicine and has worked with the Italian Ministry as a consultant for substance use disorder treatment. He's director of addiction research and the Italian Observatory on Drugs, and for the last 13 years has worked with the United Nations. He's worked on the International Narcotic Control Board, and he's currently the chief of drug prevention and the health branch of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. So if you'd like to join me in a warm welcome for Dr. Gilberto Gera.
Many thanks for inviting me. I'm very happy to be here representing the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime based in Vienna. And let me thank, first of all, the Director General, Dr. Mohammad, for this engagement, for involving the UNODC, the United Nations Office on this. I was expressing my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Mohammad for engaging the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime in this conference, and particularly also Dr. Jeff Wilkins for engaging us. The United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime is really represented by me today, but also by our colleague of the representative in the Gulf, Dr. Atem Ali, and Dr. Asma Fakhri, who are working here in the Gulf with you permanently in our office here in Abu Dhabi. And let me say that I convey to you the best wishes and the greetings of Mr. Yuri Fedotov, the executive director of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. Mr. Fedotov was absolutely intentional to come. He was absolutely interested to come to be here present with you personally. But because of the coincidence of the beginning of the crime commission that is starting Monday, he was not able to attend. And so you have to do what we can with my presence, with my speech. And let me say that I have also to congratulate the government of Qatar for what they are doing in Naufar. Now we have this perfect coincidence of this conference together with the inauguration of this center. And I think we are seeing this center such as an excellent center that will become very soon a reference for the region, not only the Gulf, but also I hope North Africa and other Islamic countries in Central Asia. And could be that this center is going to increase the network of centers that we have all around the world to disseminate the science-based practice. In particular, look to the in 2016, we published together with the World Health Organization the International Standard of Treatment for Drug Use Disorder. And I think that we have not to come and teach here what is the content of the International Standard of Treatment, because NAUFAR is already in line with this approach. Clearly, we would like to establish a partnership with this center, as we have partnership with other states in the region, to establish a sort of permanent cooperation in this perspective. But let me start with another very important thing that your Director General has said before. That is my dream. He said that we did understand very soon that it's not all black and white. These were your words. And I always dream, every morning I dream to meet policymakers, decision makers, lawmakers, or practitioners who understand very well about addiction to drugs and addiction in general, that is not all black and white, that there is an enormous complexity, and we have to deal with the complexity of a human being suffering in this situation, trapped in this situation. The fact that we have here in your Director General a person recognizing this is for me an enormous starting. It's also the starting of science, because in science you never say, I am sure that the things are going in this way, black or white. But you have continuous doubts that are permitting you to explore and to understand better the reality you are dealing with. Now, my presentation today will be a sort of strange mixture between science and the presentation of what the General Assembly last year said in April 2016 in New York. I don't know if you are aware that there was the HANGAS, the United Nations General Assembly Special Session on Drugs in 2016 in April, and it was after 18 years. The previous one was in 1998. So for 16 years, there was no General Assembly devoted to drugs only. And this one was extremely important because if you read the outcome document coming out from the General Assembly, you find an enormous amount of innovative and science-based things that I will try to mention in my presentation, based on science, based on evidence. Let me start with the statement. You see this statement, they say, we recognize drug dependence, this is the language of the General Assembly, the resolution of the General Assembly. We recognize that drug dependence is a complex, multifactorial health disorder. Look, complex and multifactorial, not black and white. Language of the General Assembly of the United Nations in New York, now our headquarters. And this text has been approved by 193 member states out of 193, so unanimously approved by member states in the UN. And at a certain point, they say that is a complex, multifactorial health disorder. You can tell me, Gerard, this is nothing innovative. We know this since 30 years ago, that is an health disorder. Let me understand why, in this sense, prevention and treatment, where I go around on mission all around the world, I have the global responsibility for prevention and treatment, I found member states that are putting in charge the Ministry of Interior or the Ministry of Justice and not the Ministry of Health if it is an health disorder. 63% of the countries have the Ministry of Interior in charge, the police in charge for prevention and treatment of this health disorder. And why I find my patients sometimes that are trapped in small cages of bamboo that are used for 21 days for detoxification, or they are immersed in water with ice to aggravate the withdrawal syndrome instead of alleviating the withdrawal syndrome, or they are chained to the wall with the chain, such as dogs. So all the violation I see in doing addiction treatment, no? And they are presented as addiction treatment, detention camps, strange things that have nothing to do with treatment, are not reflecting still in the practice, in the clinical practice of every day, what has been said by the General Assembly. And here in Naufar, we will have properly a new light, no? Enlightening the region, saying we have to go in this direction, not punishment, but treatment, not discrimination, but appropriate social cohesion and support. So it is recognized that it is caused by social causes and consequences that can be prevented and treatment. It is absolutely a new universe that now is accepted by all member states. And as I said, it was not accepted in a small village, but it was accepted in this headquarter of the UN. And we are not in front of a moral failure. We are not in front of a criminal attitude. We are not in front of a social trend that is fascinating the young people. We are not in face of a free choice that I decide where I decide to take drugs and I decided to continue or decided to develop addiction. There is nothing to be decided there. There is a long series of disadvantages making you conditioned to decide. And for sure, I don't like this word, there is nothing recreational in this story. There is a lot of suffering if you go behind what is presented as recreational. The language of the UN was in this document of the General Assembly continuously mentioning the science-based approach. And in the 2 years before the General Assembly, we have had two resolutions saying that the international community dealing with the world drug problem has to have a continuous dialogue with the scientific community. In not one but two resolutions has been said by the Commission on Narcotic Drugs. If you have doubts about the complexity, I present to you this my own small model, no? That is very difficult to follow, but to give you an idea that you start with situations that are related to gene variants and poor social environments, influencing the temperament, influencing the relationship parent-child, influencing the condition of stress during childhood and adolescence. And you have these factors already affecting initiation. Because you know, I meet a lot of people around the world who say, yes, I understand, Gerard, it is a disease, it is an health disorder, but it is a self-acquired health disorder. No, self-acquired means that it is your fault, because you decided once to take cannabis, you decided once to take alcohol as your free choice, and this makes you guilty, because you have a disease that you provoked to yourself. On the contrary, scientific literature tells us that there are a lot of factors co-occurring and concurring and contributing to also the disaster of initiation, of experimenting with drugs. That is already a first step to develop then the continuous use and the addictive behavior. You know, I have put in red the news of the last 10 years,
The bad news of the last 10 years that I will mention about this in my presentation, the issue of epigenetics. We have now no more only genetic factors contributing, concurring to the disease, but epigenetic factors. When I say epigenetics, means changes in gene translation, changes in gene expression that are making the disease so chronic and so stable and relapsing. And imagine that this is an interview done to colleagues in Germany, not to public opinion, but to colleagues in a very science-based approach country, such as Germany. But our practitioner, our physician in Germany, are defining this L disorder simply people weak-minded. Weak-minded means it's not a disease. I repeat, this is not a statement done by the public opinion, by the people in the street. It's done by the physicians operating in the health system. And people are ignoring that here we are in front of a very complex situation, exactly for any other disease. As you know, being exposed to salt is not provoking hypertension. Being exposed to sugar is not provoking diabetes. And being exposed to drugs per se is not provoking an health disorder such as drug addiction. And clearly, there is something other that is concurring to the disease. You see, we have unbelievable, from the studies of the genetic studies that are going to look to the irritability in twins, in siblings, and in family studies, we have already information related to 30% or 70%, depending on the study, of the role of genetics in this disease. Or 50% for alcohol dependence has been established. It's exactly the average between 30% and 70%. But what happens to the other part, the part that is not genetics? No, clearly, if it is 50%, there is another 50% that is related to adverse social experience, adverse childhood experiences. And the tragedy is that normally people think that someone can be disadvantaged because he has genetic influence, and someone other can be disadvantaged because they have adverse childhood experiences. But unfortunately, the situation in life is the opposite, is that you have both inherited factors, genetic factors, and also terrible experience in your life because of the attitude of your parents related to this genetics. Look to this. For me, when I present this slide, I have a sort of emotion, of negative emotion. I call it the slides of inequality. Look at some of the polymorphism of the gene variants that are creating a proneness to alcoholism and to drugs are going to be concentrated in socially deprived districts or regions of the countries. So where you have already poverty, you have already social exclusion and marginalization, there you have a higher level, higher concentration, higher rate of this polymorphism making you vulnerable for drugs and alcohol. People are living in a sort of social isolation. They are marrying each other. They are transmitting each other these genes, making them more prone to drugs and alcohol, more prone to poverty generated by this, in a sort of a vicious cycle, no, a malignant cycle that is difficult to interrupt if you don't break the isolation of this socially deprived community. I am also very happy when I see this article of Agrawal and Linsky, 2006, saying that all the stages of cannabis use, abuse, and dependence are related to genetics. Not only the development of abuse and dependence, but also initiation. This was mentioned again by Dr. Volkov, the Director General of NIDA, together with Professor Kube and Professor McClellan, when they say that also the initiation to drugs is related to genetic factors. So there are children who are able to say no to drugs because of their temperament, and there are children that, because of their temperament, are unable to say no, or so much less able to say no respect to other children. This has to be recognized as the pathogenesis, as the initial pathogenesis of the disease. This is one of my studies where I demonstrated in a population of adolescents in schools, in secondary school, I demonstrated that, for example, the people experimenting with drugs were carrying the genotype of the short genotype with an impairment, a dysfunction of the serotonin transporter at 26%. The people abstinent never touched drugs in the secondary school, only 11%, less than the half they were carrying this genotype. If you look to the characteristic of the temperament of the children, of the adolescents, the students, that were carrying the short genotype, making the serotonin transporter dysfunctional, you find 21 novelty-seeking attitude with the Kloninger scale respect to 15%, and 59 of aggressiveness, direct aggressiveness on the Basdar key hostility inventory respect to 51. So what is doing the gene? The genes are influencing the temperament or the proneness to aggressiveness, making you more vulnerable for drugs. This is also a more complete description of what the genes are doing. The genes are influencing the metabolism of drugs, such as, for example, alcohol dehydrogenases or the free acid amide hydroxylases that is metabolizing the endogenous cannabinoid and cannabis. And then they are influencing the effects of drugs and alcohol on neurotransmitters and neuromodulators pathways. And they are also influencing some characteristic of the personality, as I said, that are making you vulnerable for drugs. Altogether, they are very predisposing to drugs, the genetic factors. But I don't know if you have ever thought to this, the fact that genes are also influencing not only drugs directly because of the things I said before, but because they go to undermine the parent-child attachment relationship. You cannot imagine how many, in my clinical practice, how many mothers came to my office with what they call in Italy, the family is very strong, no? They come with the mother is coming with the child. The child is 28 years old, affected by drug addiction. They say, oh, my child was a problematic child from the very beginning. And I said, Madame, please tell me what was the problematic situation. Ah, with the first one, it was always a miracle. The first one was smiling, was taking the milk, was available to everything. Now he's in Harvard as an engineer. No, the second one was problematic from the very beginning. From the very beginning, he was not accepting the normal maneuver to change the pampers. He was kicking me. And then he was splitting the soup when I have to move from the milk to the soup. And the mother is describing a long list of problematic situations with the newborn. If you go to the scientific literature, you find low compliance newborns who are not able to accept the normal maneuvers, the normal things that a newborn has to do. And clearly the mother and the father are saying, yes, we love both of them with the same love. But unconsciously, the second one was developing a different and less organized and less solid form of attachment with the mother because of his temperament. So the genes are aggravating the situation, going to undermine your relationship with the mother. But now also some good news we have to consider. For example, that I told you how much genetics is important in this disease. Now I have to tell you how much it is not important in reality, contradicting myself. In reality, the high quality rearing environment, the good parenting, is able really to change the risk and to vanish the risk induced by genetics. We have this evidence of involved supporting parenting that is going to completely cancel the relationship or to completely reduce the relationship between the transporter of serotonin that I've shown before and the risk of the disease. This is my study. If you put together, I studied these four components. Clearly, serotonin transporter gene, short allele, you have seen is predisposing you to develop substance initiation. But the significance of this relationship is going to disappear when you consider the role of maternal and paternal neglect or care. If you have a good care, the influence of genes is disappearing, is going to vanish, the significance is disappearing. And if you have neglect and abuse in childhood, it clearly is becoming really significant, the relationship between the genes and substance abuse. And another big actor in this scenario is the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis, that is the hormonal system in response to stress. These children are affected by a sort of changes in this axis that they making them very vulnerable. And as I said before, we have evidence today of the fact that both stress during childhood and drugs are changing gene expression, are making portion of genes silenced and other portion of genes activated. Not only you are born with a certain inherited gene pattern, but also your genes are remodulated, rewritten, re-expressed because of the epigenetic changes that are methylation or acetylation of the histones. I was mentioning to this particularly for the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis. Being exposed to stress during childhood is going to create this situation of a hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis that is always hyperactive when it's not necessary, unable to respond to stress when this is becoming necessary in life. I published this article showing that addiction severity is related to these changes in the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis, altered response to emotion, and ultimately related to childhood neglect. But look to this. This is article of Dr. Zhang saying that in humans, in childhood adversity could induce methylation alterations, so changes in gene expression, and inducing with this the risk of substance use disorder. You see which kind of genes are involved, the GABA genes, the alcohol dehydrogenase gene, the opioid receptor genes, the cholinergic genes, dopamine receptor genes, all genes that are absolutely crucial in the development of our disease are affected by adverse childhood experiences and the methylation that are changing the reading of our genes. I know that we've had a great expert of brain imaging here with us today, Dr. Stein, but I wanted to show some evidence about brain imaging, demonstrating that we have changes induced in the brain, measurable changes induced by the brain by extreme poverty and stress during poverty, during childhood. And look to what happens to these children. We have an hyperactive amygdala, that is the store of emotion, and the hypoactive prefrontal cortex, that is the emotional regulation, is the brake of the car, is the control of the car. Imagine going in front of life, in front of an environment that is full of drugs, where drugs are available, when you have this kind of condition pre-existing. And when they call recreation, after I presented this long series of slides, I start to ask you, can you call this issue recreational? They say, oh, the recreational use of drugs. Which kind of recreational use of drugs we can consider? The recreational use of drugs of privileged people taking some lines of cocaine in a party with the wealthy people, or the recreational use of drugs of people living with their dogs in the garbage in a marginalized area? It's a big violation of human rights to consider drugs recreational. The drugs are recreational for a small number of privileged people in rich countries, and they are a dramatic situation, punishing terribly people who are affected by not only by drugs, but by poverty and social marginalization in other countries. The same I ask for cannabis. They tell me, is cannabis dangerous for our adolescents? Look to this study, saying that if you are carrying only methionine or methionine valine in your polymorphism, affecting the gene of COMT, controlling COMT. COMT is a catecholorthomethyltransferase. It is an enzyme metabolizing adrenaline. If you have, you are carrying methionine, you are protected from the effect of cannabis. You can smoke and you develop, only in a small rate, you develop a schizophreniform disorder at the age of 26. But if you are carrying only valine in this genotype, for only one single nucleotide polymorphism, imagine, you develop a huge amount of consequences in terms of psychiatric consequences. So when people with a certain superficiality, they say, oh, cannabis is soft, cannabis is doing nothing, I always ask, for whom? Now, there are people that, for example, for genetic reason, are paying very bitterly, are paying dramatically their exposure to cannabis. But look on the right side of the screen. This is not genetic. If you have a sexual trauma in your history, because you have been abused sexually in your history as a child, you develop the same level of psychotic reaction when you smoke cannabis, also if not related to genes, but related in this case to your clinical traumatic history. Prevention. Let me say that the General Assembly of the United Nations is telling us that we have to promote this kind of life skills, education, parenting skills, and reliable information. Good access to education and preventing school dropouts as a large framework of health, welfare, and well-being for our children. This is the first prevention. And I have a slide that I used for my Christmas card wishes. Is this slide showing people happy in school. As more as we have people very engaged in school and very happy to be there, no, as a privilege to be in school, these people are really protected from drugs. And we have what to do in practice. We have published it in 2013. We are doing the revision now, this interesting book of describing all the methodologies with the science literature revision that is showing what is working, what is not working in prevention. You can find in this book that we have given every methodology of prevention, the stars such as the restaurant and the hotel. So you can find five stars methodology that are really supported by consolidated scientific literature, other that are less and less and less until only anecdotal reports. Look to this study. In prevention, what is becoming very evident is that if you have what is called authoritative parenting, that is not authoritarian, is not neglectful parenting, but is strong interest in children, care for children, rule setting, supervision, you go to reduce one third the initiation of nicotine, simply because of the attitude of the parents. It is an enormous amount. Imagine how many consequences you go to avoid with this kind of things. And I want you to remember this before finishing my section on prevention. You remember this as a very important thing. Among the mammals, you know, the expression of care is licking. Among the rats, among the cats, and also big cats as this. And this study has found that the offspring, the pups, that are not receiving this licking as a sign of care, they have gene expression changes related to epigenetic modulation and methylation. Can you imagine? We are speaking about social deprivation expressed in this so concrete way that is going to change the expression of our genes. So the importance of parenting, we have had for 2 years a campaign promoted by UNODC together with the support of France and Sweden that is called Listen First. Before speaking to your children, listen them. Don't listen only with the ears, but listen with the heart. Don't listen only when you understand, also we don't understand them. Listen to them when they don't speak. Listen to them when they say things that make you angry or are disappointing for you. And then the huge, enormous effort that we do with the UNODC Youth Initiative to change the condition, not having youth as a target of prevention, but having youth as the partners of prevention in the community, making them really proactive and active and engaged in the prevention work. But in the General Assembly, we have we did understand a new attitude. This is language of the General Assembly again. No stigmatizing attitude, no social marginalization, no discriminatory access to treatment, community-based treatment, outreach programs, long-term recovery, all the words that I have seen pronounced in the presentation of your Director General here in Naufar. And we know also that I presented to you what happens before drugs, what makes you vulnerable for drugs. But let me say some words about what happens when you are exposed to drugs. You have a lot of changes in your brain neurotransmission, making you dysfunctional at a psychological level, behavioral level, motivational, cognitive, and memory. And let me show, this is really the model, the last model presented in January 2016 by Volkov, Kub, and McClellan. And it is the impressive description of what happens in the addictive brain. If I would be the medical director of the center, and there is a family coming tomorrow morning, no, with a new patient, and I ask them, what do you want? What do you expect from us? And normally the parents are saying that is stopping drugs, no? But this is not enough. They should be informed that they have to ask for a more difficult thing. The extinction of this vicious cycle, this compulsive conditioned cycle, that make the people completely conditioned of using, injecting, binge, having this intoxication to obtain a reward, then having the negative consequences of withdrawal and negative effect, then having a sort of preoccupation anticipation. Because when the addictive behavior is becoming a true addictive behavior, the binge, the intoxication, is moving from euphoria to escaping dysphoria. It means that you are not anymore obtaining a pleasure or a reward from drugs. You are trying to restore a normal situation and you don't succeed in this because the withdrawal and negative effect are becoming through depression and anxiety. And the sort of normal preoccupation anticipation to obtain new drugs to inject or to use or to snort, it is no more a normal preoccupation, but it is an obsession. And in this trap, in this cycle, that is compulsive conditioned trap, you have what is called a sort of a motivational system hijacked by drugs. And you have a what is called an abnormal associative learning, because the associative learning can be obtained with food or any other pleasure, but is a very easy to obtain an extinction. Why? With drugs, we don't have a simple extinction respect to any other reward, because drugs are operating something different in the brain. So the question of our family coming tomorrow morning to the center, to Naufar, and asking for help should be, please, we give you in May 2017, we would like that in May 2018, the level of compulsory conditioned behavior in our child has decreased. At least a certain amount of compulsory behavior has obtained an extinction. And this is moving toward the possibility for our child to decide for his future, for his behavior, focusing no more on drugs only, but to the normal rewarding goals of life. What we have in front of us, in front of treatment necessity, we have a dramatic situation. One out of six people are receiving treatment in the world today, of the people in need, one out of six. But you already understand that when I say one, we don't know which kind of treatment this one is receiving. Sometimes it's receiving the things that are presented as treatment that are simply punishment or detention. And you see, in Africa, the situation is one out of 18. So a very dramatic situation. For the gender issue, for the females, is much less, because one out of three are drug users, the females, but one out of five only are receiving treatment. And what we have to start? We have to start from low threshold intervention and outreach intervention. Not wait for the people in the office. Don't wait that they come spontaneously. Go to serve them. And I represented with these slides, I hope that you remember what I mean for low threshold intervention, no? and outreach intervention, staying really at the low level with the potential patient. And we need to develop outpatient services that are based in the community. This is in Cambodia, our pilot experiment in Cambodia, with the engagement of the family, in particular of the mothers, you can see. The General Assembly, again, give us instruction about this. You have to develop integrated treatment, psychosocial, behavioral, and medication-assisted treatment. It is, again, the text of the General Assembly. And we have evidence from the literature that this is working. If you put together opioid agonist treatment together with contingency management and cognitive behavioral therapy, for example, you obtain a great advantage. And the American Society for Addiction Medicine also underlined how much combining psychosocial treatment and medication is effective. In this case, you have now not only methadone, but also Vivitrol, that is the long-term naltrexone intervention, covering for 1 month with an intramuscle injection. Sorry, probably this is not so easy to read, but it's one of my studies demonstrating the difference between medical supervision, contingency management take-home methadone, and the take-home methadone without any contingency management. If you simply give methadone to people to bring home, the result is a disaster. You have more diversion, more people injecting heroin and injecting methadone itself, or crime and violence episodes. If you use contingency management, you give methadone only to stabilize people, or medical supervision, you obtain much better results. And this cannot be ignored. Many centers are consuming the role of methadone, simply giving big bags of methadone to bring home without any control. These are the 3 weeks from opioid that you obtain with Vivitrol. You see it in green, the enormous advantage to use Vivitrol respect to placebo. So we have tools. And in the future, we have to look to the problem, our pharmacological response also for stimulants user. We cannot imagine to offer them only counseling, only some psychosocial intervention. They are not appealing for them. We have to explore. We have not found the result still in the scientific literature. We have to explore which kind of pharmacological response we have to offer to the people affected by stimulant dependence. We have a long list of effective non-pharmacological treatment modalities, psychosocial treatment intervention, and I am sure that Naufar can teach us this kind of methodologies. And we have not to forget the issue of co-occurring mental health disorder. Imagine, this is a therapeutic community, I think in Mexico, going to see 62% of the co-occurring mental health disorder. When I speak with policymakers, most of the time, they tell me, ah, Gerra, there is a minority of patients affected by mental health disorder, no? Together with addiction as a disease. And they tell them, which kind of a small amount of patients? How many they are, in your opinion? Literature say that among the outpatients, you have 47-43% of people affected by mental health disorder together with addiction. And if you go to prison or to therapeutic community, to residential treatment, you reach 62% or 65%. And this is an example I treated in my past life with Zyprexa, with olanzapine, people with schizophrenic form disorder obtaining an enormous increase in retention in treatment when they were treated also for their psychiatric comorbidity. Forgetting to treat the psychiatric comorbidity means that you condemn the people to relapse. And finally, look the essential issue of overdose prevention with the indication to provide take-home naloxone to everyone to bring in the hands of the society in general. The girlfriend, the boyfriend, the friends, the parents have to have naloxone in their hands to save people from overdose. Still, with the intervention also related to HIV, AIDS are so minimal, are so limited in around the world. We have in front of us a huge battle to fight again. You see that only 14% are obtaining antiretroviral therapy for the people affected by HIV. For the people using drugs, injecting drugs, you have only 10% who obtain clean needles and only 8% treated with opioid substitution treatment. And don't forget the risk of HIV among people using stimulants. This study is demonstrating that there is not big difference between injecting and non-injecting in risk of HIV, because the people not injecting are exposed to the risk of lack of control, and most of the time they are exposed to unprotected sex because of their mentality, because of their situation under the effect of stimulants. Finally, the General Assembly again said the patient has to do the treatment with their informed consent. Confidentiality has been mentioned before, and informed consent. It means that mandatory treatment for the General Assembly is not accepted. Clearly, you have the situation where you need to do mandatory treatment for a situation that is threatening life or threatening the security, and you have to intervene for 10, 15 days in covering this terrible crisis of behavioral crisis of the patient. But apart from this, the treatment has to be voluntary-based, has to be with the consent of the patient. And we have written many years ago already this document that was called From Coercion to Cohesion, stopping prison and stopping coercive treatment, stopping mandatory treatment, and offering this patient the cohesion and the support of the community. What to do in practice? You can read, as I said before, in the International Standard of Treatment. I'm very proud that we have done, you see the two logos with WHO. With this marriage that we have with WHO, clearly any cooperation with us is also a cooperation with the World Health Organization. And let me conclude with the last two things. One is the importance of designing specific pathways for treatment related to women. Women are normally, they have no access to treatment. They are double discriminated because of being females and affected by drug use disorder. They have the problem of children management. They have problems related to sexual reproductive health care. And all these things have to be predisposed for our response to women. And finally, the suggestion to engage civil society organizations, NGOs, in the management of this problem creating what I call a treatment system, not a treatment center alone in isolation. And let me conclude really celebrating this historical perspective. This is my program. I see here Dr. Ahmad, who was in the committee of this program, a joint program with WHO that we started in 2009. Imagine that after 10 years, almost 10 years, we have had a marriage. The 27th of February, Dr. Chan, the Director General of WHO, and Dr. Yuri Fedotov signed a memorandum of understanding in Geneva, promising collaboration in seven areas of the potentially to be developed between the two organizations. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gerra. We have time for a very quick question, if anybody in the audience would like to address anything to Dr. Jura.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gavarda. That was extremely interesting to start our conference. What I'm interested in, I work with families, with some of the excellent clinicians here in Nofer, and you mentioned some very, very interesting points on parenting behavior and early attachment patterns. So my question is, do you feel that some positive parenting programs would be a very good program to bring into Nofer?
I did not hear very well your question, but I understand that you ask about this parent-child attachment. This is absolutely essential in prevention because we have identified that parenting skills education programs are the most effective in prevention in general with the children. And we have not to disseminate very psychological things that are very complex to learn by the parents. This is not the way. We have to disseminate very simple things such as undivided time to be spent with the children, such as setting rules in the life of the family, such as supervision that is asking where are you going to do what with whom and when you come back, and also warm child rearing style. I support you also when you are in condition of failure. But this is for prevention. But this could become a very important area also of treatment when you go in a certain sense to repair, to restore the interpersonal relationship with the family. It is very difficult to find a patient who is starting fully the long road of recovery and the long-term management of recovery without being reattached with the family, without solving problems that has affected his life in the last 15 or 20 years with this broken relationship with the family. And this could become a sort of going to restore. There are studies showing that intensive caregiving in the adult can revert the epigenetic changes. It means that the intensive caregiving and restoring this important relationship with the family can become a sort of also biological, can induce biological changes, repairing the damage done during the stressful situation in childhood.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jura. I think we could listen to you all day, but we'll press on. So please join me in a show of appreciation there.